Hey, how you doing? If you're a viewer that's watched my videos before, welcome back. If you're a new viewer, thanks for tuning in. And today I'm at the Colorado River here on the Texas Gulf Coast. I'm outside of Eagle Lake, Texas. It's a town a few miles that way. And we're at the Colorado River with the USS Science boat. We're under a very noisy highway, so apologies for the highway traffic sounds. But we're gonna be taking this boat, plunking it in that river, and taking a look at some incised valley deposits. Now, a lot of people think they know a lot about incised valleys. A lot of people think valleys are simply stacks of sand or stacks of fluvial systems. There's a lot more to them than that. And in this case, we're quite a ways from the coast. We're about an hour and a half drive from the coast. So what is that, about 70 miles, 80 miles from the coastline, further with the river because it meanders. But as you probably already know, incised valleys are bigger than single channels. There's a lot of stacked fluvial channels in valleys, but there's stuff between the channels. There's floodplain deposits in the valleys. There's lacustrine lake deposits. It can be marsh. It can be salt marsh. It can be marine bay fill deposits in the valleys, depending on where you are in relation to the coastline. So today we're upstream, not anywhere near the coast, nothing marine, nothing brackish water in here. We're just going to show you some of the stuff in these totally fluvial incised valleys. And I'll show you a little bit about the sediments in the bottom. I'm going to show you some of the valley wall features, and we're going to see what we see. So as I mentioned, this is the SS Science boat. It's just a little 14-foot John boat. I just got done replacing the carburetor and the water pump and the fuel filter and the spark plug in the engine. So hopefully everything's going to keep running today. If not, I've got a little electric trolling motor on the back to keep us moving forward. As you see, there's a sonar unit, so we're going to be able to see the bottom contours. We're going to be able to see the sediments, and we'll show you some interesting things in the Colorado River incised valley. So stick around, you're not going to want to miss this. Okay, so as we're cruising up the river, we've come to our first bank of interest, and it's this very sandy bank. Those are actually Holocene deposits. Those are actually point bar deposits or bank attached deposits. They're a couple of thousand years old. I think the luminescence data is giving us something around like 1600, 1800 years old. So they're not very old, just, you know, not quite 2000 years old. So that's some Holocene stuff sitting in the valley up against the valley wall. You can see it's pretty wide here. This river is very wide, and the valley itself is even wider. So the river is maybe like 100 meters wide. The valley itself at this point is about 4 kilometers wide from side to side. Down south of us, it expands three times that. It's something like 12, 13 kilometers wide. So we're gonna go take a look up around the bend there. And we're gonna see what the valley wall looks like when we get away from where it's getting deposited. We're gonna look at some stuff that's actually being eroded. It's the actual original valley wall. So the sonar unit comes in very handy because we can see in relation to the bridge that we launched under, we're just a little bit north of the bridge. We're going upstream. Here's what the bottom looks like. And you can see we're at about 5 feet of depth, so it's not very deep here. In fact, the whole channel here is about 5 feet, so about a meter and a half, meter and two-thirds deep. You can see there's some rugosity to it. Partly that's an artifact of the boats, a little bit rocking in the waves. But the other thing is we're actually seeing bed forms. So we're actually seeing little downstream accreting dunes. Now, these aren't very convincing. I'll show you some better ones up here. Okay, so we're cruising along the river now. We're still going upstream north against the current. And behind me, you can see those Holocene 1500, 1800 year old deposits on the river. Some of them might even be kind of younger. They look pretty fresh, actually. They're trodden on by cows, which is part of the reason they look so fresh. We're coming up on a transition, though. So look at that. That's depositional. And now look behind me here. That's erosional. That's all the bedrock. Continues on behind me, and that's where we're headed. So we're going to take a look at this bedrock, see what exactly it is. You can see there's some cliff-forming material in it. Cliffs, as good as we get down here on the Texas Gulf Coast anyway. So let's take a look and see what it is. Look at that. That is some heavy-duty, coarse-grained sandstone conglomerate. It's got some trees rooted on it. but it's pretty heavily cemented, very coarse grain cross-bedded sandstone making up that valley wall. This is the Miocene-aged Goliad formation. So we've got Miocene rocks being incised and deposited on top of them is Holocene. There's some Pleistocene up there in the tree line as well, but this is the actual valley wall. It's worth pointing out that we're in some deeper parts of the river here up against those valley walls. It dropped down to about 14, 15 feet, and now we're kind of dipping back up into about 10 or 12 feet. So the river narrows here and actually entrenches. It gets deeper down in these really well-consolidated Miocene deposits. Looks like there's some big fish down there, too. The river's able to cut way down into them, down to about 10 or 12, 14 feet in some cases. So about 3 meters, 4 meters, even approaching 5 meters in some areas. So as we're cruising along, taking a look at what's on the banks behind us and what's on the sonar unit, let's talk about the three ways you can create base level fall, river incision, and valley formation. There's three of them, like I said, and most people are familiar with the first two. The first two are, number one, it's tectonics. You can have some sort of uplift causing local area to go up, which causes the valleys to form as the rivers cut down to try to stay at base level, which is, of course, the level that they're ultimately trying to get to. That's either lake level or sea level or just whatever the ultimate bottom stage of the river is. The second way is, of course, sea level or lake level fall. And that can be if you have glaciation, you might have the basin gets some extra depth out there somewhere and creates greater accommodation, causing the water to subside. Again, rivers will follow that down. The third way is climatic, and that's getting a lot of traction lately. People are paying more attention than they used to. But with climate, the deal is when you have a moister, wetter climate, there's a lot of moisture stored in the overbank deposits. When that climate turns dry, you have less storage capacity in the floodplain because the groundwater table is a lot further down. So the river will kind of incise further down, and when you do get a big flood, the river cannot jump out of the floodplain. My motor just stalled out, so I'm gonna have to deal with that in a second. But keep in mind, a natural experiment with the climate has happened with beavers. And beavers in the western US and Canada, with their extraction and removal from the 1800s on, that's actually caused a major change in a lot of rivers where they're becoming incised and valleys because the floodplain has less storage capacity of water. Water table goes down during the dry season, incision happens. So we know it happens, and it happens at a smaller scale with beavers. It's actually a pretty big scale. It's basically continental scale. But imagine if it happened at a climatic scale, like for example, from the Pleistocene to Holocene. I'm gonna take a look at the motor, try to figure it out, and then we'll keep going. So here we are cruising along in the river, happily minding our own business, and look what happens to the depth. We just went from 5 feet to 0 feet. There's like no depth here at all. We're right up against the bank where the thalweg ought to be. So I'm gonna try to find some deeper water in here. But look at that, we are at like zero depth. I know it gets deeper closer to the bank, so we're gonna try to avoid sucking up too much sand and sediment into the water pump, which I just replaced. There we go, we're better. Okay, back to it. All right, I got the motor running again. It's happy, just need to adjust the carb a little bit. But behind me there's a sandy bank. So that's another depositional Holocene point bar. And you notice there's a couple of steps on it. There's the uppermost step and then there's one about halfway down. That second one is actually a slump where the upper part of the bank has kind of come down and collapsed. So it's partly a bank failure that's caused that. So the bar has been obviously incised because you have a cliff there. So the older bar has been incised and then gravity has kind of taken that slump down. So you've got that terrace effect. Now, sometimes that can be depositional. You might have a secondary bar developing there and that terrace will affect the hydraulics. You might get some sediment building on top of it. And again, just to emphasize how shallow this valley can be in some spots or how shallow the river channel can be in the valley. Here's a bar that's emergent mid-channel So that's right smack dab in the middle of the channel. And we are at about 4 feet deep on that side of the bar. Okay, I just had to take a moment and show you something really cool on the side of the valley here. There's that Miocene rock we're incising into. So there's some of the Miocene bedrock with some sediment on top of it. But the cool thing is up there. See those plants? That's Neocalamites, the horsetails. It's pretty similar to the ones that were growing in the Mesozoic and the Paleozoic. Of course, they were much bigger in the Paleozoic, but they have that same jointed texture to them, that same jointed structure. They're not true vascular plants. They go back a long ways, but it's really cool that they're hanging out here. We're on this bank of the river channel, the modern river channel. You can see all the trees have slumped down in. Again, gravity's kind of having its way with the bank. So all the Holocene deposits and some of the Miocene stuff underneath, there's that differential between them, the really consolidated Miocene and the really loose Holocene. So this stuff tends to slump in. So you can see it takes the trees with it, it takes all the landscaping, and even our friends, the horsetails, go down with it. We're gonna come up and take a look in this little creek. This is a tributary creek. And again, tributaries are very common in valleys and erosional river systems. Here's the main river channel out here. Everything's flowing towards us with the cut bank. And this is a little feeder creek, a little tributary creek coming into the main channel. Holy cow, look at this. There's some coarse grain stuff in here. You can see, depth-wise, this creek, it's about maybe 10 meters from the top there down, 8 or 10 meters. But look at this. There's all this very, very well consolidated, coarse-grained, burrowed and rooted material, some sort of bioturbation happening in that. You can see some really coarse-grained stringers, cobbles and pebbles in this. This is that Miocene Goliad formation. So here we are at the bedrock of the Colorado Incised Valley. We are in a tributary, in a wall. Man, that is pretty exciting stuff. And it just continues on up that way, around the corner, into that little cobble field that we're not gonna be able to get past in a boat anyway. But I just noticed the water is really, really clear. And in that clear water, you can see some round shapes in the gravel down the bottom. And those are actually fish nests. Probably sunfish, but there's also cichlids. There's Rio Grande cichlids that are nesting in here. I just thought it was worth pointing out the shapes on the sonar unit. We're going upstream. So look at that. There's a steep side and a shallow side. Steep side, shallow side. Steep side, shallow side. We're actually seeing the bed forms on the base of the Thalweg at the bottom of the river. So we're seeing some fairly sizable beds. They're about a foot tall, if we go by the depth on the screen. Okay, so we're coming up on that bend here, and there's actually a point bar on that bank. And I know that because there's the point bar on that bank. Okay, this seems like a good spot to kind of summarize everything we've talked about in this video. Right here behind me are some older Holocene deposits on the cut bank of the Colorado River. You can see the cut bank with all its nice stratigraphy. It's probably an abandoned channel fill. This is probably not a point bar. It's mostly mud, there's some silt, maybe some bivalve shells in it, but it's very fine grained stuff, very muddy, silty stuff. So it's a cut bank. You can see there's some terracing on the distance where it's kind of slumping down because of the gravity. Meanwhile, opposite side of the river, there's our friend, the point bar, the nice, clean, sandy point bar with a flat depositional surface, continues upstream, downstream, trees in the distance, just like it's supposed to on a textbook. So we got fluvial deposits with very prominent cut banks of older material, older Holocene, and in some cases even Miocene material. So the key difference between an incised valley like this and a big fluvial channel is that the valley is cutting into progressively older deposits, stacking itself not just laterally, not just vertically up, but also can be cutting down. In this case, we're seeing evidence of slumping downward, but also the channel adjusting downward over time. If it was adjusting up at this point, it would be up and out of the banks, but it's not. So it's still actually cutting itself down. And in fact, where we are here is a relatively new channel of the Colorado. An older channel is just a couple of miles that way in what's called Caney Creek. It's been abandoned for a while. So hopefully you had a good time exploring the river with me in Science Boat. We got the motor working. Everything's great today. Going to be looking at some distal versions of this very same valley in a future video. So we're going to go down to the coast. We're going to look at the Bayhead Delta. Did that in another video, and I'll attach a link to that in the description here. So take a look down there. You'll see the link. We're going to do a little bit more exploring in the Bayhead Delta and compare it to some other incised valleys. Here in Texas, we got a bunch of them. We got the Trinity, we got the Brazos, we got this one, we got the Sabine. So we're pretty lucky to have a bunch of cool incised valleys to take a look at. Some are overfilled, some are underfilled. We'll talk more about that in the next video. So until next time, thanks for watching. Get out from behind your computer. I know you're watching on a computer or a phone right now, but that's okay. Step away from it at some point. Get outside, look at rocks, look at sediments. The present is the key to the past. If you're looking at incised valleys and subsurface or an outcrop, you've got to come out and take a look at the modern equivalents. Get out here, take a look at the valleys. You'll be glad you did. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.